Greetings. A camera is one of the main parts of any scene. You simply can't render a scene properly without adding and setting up a camera. And cameras are a lot more than just something to point at the scene and render it. In this video, we are going to look at how you can improve your scene by using them properly. This is the scene that I am going to use for this, a simple free environment with a man sitting there. Let's start with the basics. First of all, we need to create a camera. This can be done by either using the Create list from the top bar, New Camera button here, or with the toolbar right here in this Create a New Camera button. After clicking on it, we will see a new window appear. Here we can change the name and label of a created camera if you want. When Accept is pressed, a new camera will appear. It is right here at a seemingly random location. But in reality, it is just the default view that you can use by clicking on the Reset View button. And if you change to the camera view, you can also see that it is basically the same view as the reset one. Now we need to move the camera to a place that would catch the scene better. There are several ways to move cameras. The first and the most straightforward one is to move it in the same way you move any other object. This means selecting your object and using the parameters window, where you can find all the transforms here, in the general section. Using these values we can move an object on all three axes. And also rotate it too. This works from the camera view too, so you can see changes that you make in real time. Another way to move the camera is a very simple one. For it, you need to be in a camera view. And while you are, you can use the regular navigation buttons to change the camera position. The same way you would have changed your perspective view. And the last method for today is to first position your perspective view the way you like it. And then create a camera. In this window, you can click on the Show Options button. That reveals the Copy Active View option. While it is active, the camera would be added exactly at the same place where your viewport is at the moment. Here you can see the camera placed where our viewport has been. And if we change to it, we will see that it is pointing at the same place too. No need for it though, so I can delete it. Now I will use the second method to position the camera in a right place. I can also use Thirds Guide that will help me in this. These lines and intersections are the points of attention, so I have made it that the character's eyes would be on one of the lines. It is time for the main treat, the camera's window. It is the main window for controlling your cameras and changing their properties. Usually, it can be found at the bottom of the panes list here. But you also can always open any window using the window, panes path. There are a lot of settings to cameras and you can see here that they are sorted in these sections. We will look into each one of them and explain what can they offer. Starting from the top with the general settings. This should look very familiar because it is basically the same thing that we had in the parameters tab. Here are all the transforms are found, so you can translate, rotate and even scale your camera. Though the last one does nothing and I don't recommend changing it at all. The more interesting option is here at the bottom, the point at. It allows you to choose any part of your scene and the camera supposed to point at it. Though selecting characters works poorly. Instead, you need to select the right bone, which can be difficult at times. But when you do, it works pretty well and positions selected bone exactly at the center of the frame. To reverse this, you just need to select the None option at the bottom. The next section is Display. It is about changing how your camera looks in the viewport. Like you can make it invisible. Or just unselectable. Change the opacity of different parts of the camera. Size and scale can be changed too. You can even change colors, to make them more visible and distinct. When you are using depth of field, two planes appear. How they look is also controlled here. To see the changes in the camera section, we need to change the camera view. The first one is very interesting. By default, the view of the camera is set to perspective. It is the same as we see with our own eyes. In simple words, closer objects seem bigger, while objects that further seem smaller. Turning the perspective view off turns on the orthographic view. In this view, every object is always the same size no matter how far or close it is. So the sink here looks huge compared to the person, for example. It is a very unusual way to view things, but also very situational. Basically, it can only be used on a scene that is made with an orthographic view in mind, something stylized. The frame width and focal length both refer to how real-world cameras work. In simple words, they allow you to zoom in and out without moving the camera at all. The depth of field option adds the depth of field effect onto your scene. Focal distance and f/stop are for managing the depth of field. Depth of field is an important one, but it is too big of a topic to talk about it right now, but you can check our last video on this channel to learn how to set up and overall work with it. By rendering the image or using the iRay viewport, you can see exactly what has changed. Quite a bit of blur has been added to a scene. By changing the focal distance and f-stop values, you can control which parts of the image would be blurred and which would be sharp. Ideally, you want the focal point to be exactly on the main part of your scene with everything that you want to be sharp, to be inside these two planes. This is how it looks now, much better. Now for the lens settings. They are a bit for more advanced users and are very much based on a real-life photography. Lens thickness in a real camera supposed to create a vignette effect. Meaning that it should darken the corners of the frame. But I don't think that it works as it should. Lens radial bias works together with depth of field, let's skip it for now. Lens shift and offset used to change the perspective of the camera and are definitely for more advanced users. Even though I have changed a lot of settings, it does not seem like it at all on the rendered result. To better show lens radial bias settings, I have changed the scene a bit. Mainly, I have added two-point lights behind the character. They are set to spheres and both have identical setups. We need them to better see the difference that lens radial bias adds. Notice how right now everything looks sharp and you can see light spheres clearly. But when I change the lens radial bias to a negative number like such, everything changes. The background is distorted now as if the camera was shaking while rendering. And straight lines begin to bend, the outlines of objects float. Next is a very interesting setting. Lens distortion type allows you to distort the whole image by any specific lens. For example, spherical distortion adds a fisheye effect to the scene. Cylindrical is similar but distorts more in height than in width. I am not sure about other types though, as they seem not to change a thing. Lower settings should help you with properly setting up the distortion and controlling it. But again, I don't seem to have anything change in the viewport while changing them. Resetting everything and jumping to the next section. Blades again work together with the depth of field setting, but also with another setting too. You can change the look of your scene if you are using a depth of field. It is best seen on the lights. Look how their shape has changed a bit after I set the blades value to 3. Another setting that works together with blades is lens radial bias. By default, it is set to 0.5, but if you change it to 0, the effect of the blade section would be more prominent. Just look at the background, especially brighter things like flowers, they now have triangular shapes. Same with the lights, they are a bit triangular, instead of being spheres. Lowering lens radial bias a little bit more can give even a better effect. Aperture blades control the shape of an object, the number that you set is the number of angles that the shape should have. I had 3, so shapes were triangles. When I set it to 4, so now they have 4 corners and create a diamond shape. Using the aperture blade rotation, I can change the rotation a bit. And now they look more like a square than diamonds. Like this, you can control the shapes that your depth of field produces. By the way, setting the value to 0, 1, or 2 would result in a default shape, because there are no figures with this number of angles. Further is the dimensions. This one is pretty simple and has only a single main use. By using the local dimension, you make this camera unique and allow it to use its own dimensions. Meaning that they can be different from the resolution and aspect ratio that are set in the render settings. Let's see that in practice. I will lower the pixel size values a lot, to only 150 pixels height and width. Notice that the render settings values are 1080 pixels, which are a lot higher. When I press render, I receive a very small image. This is definitely a 150 pixel size image. This can be used in a scene, for example, where you have multiple cameras and would want each or some of them to have individual resolution and aspect ratio. The last section is the headlamp. A headlamp is a lamp that is attached to a camera to add some lighting to a scene. So if I would hide the point lights and turn off the environmental lighting, there would be no light and everything would be black. Now I turn on a headlamp and we can see that the scene is indeed lighted. Interesting is that this light can only be seen if you are in a camera mode. Generally speaking, headlamp lighting is not very good. You would get a much better result if you use proper lights, such as point lights and environmental lighting can go a long way too. I would even recommend you to go to the render settings and turn off the auto headlamp overall. Because sometimes it can be on and you don't even notice, while it makes your scene a bit worse. Additionally to everything said previously, cameras can also be animated. We have a separate video dedicated to this topic that you can find on our YouTube channel. And on our website, renderguide.com. Where we have a lot of useful articles for 3D artists of Daz3D and Blender. Here you can find the Daz3D camera settings tutorial on which this video is based, if you want to learn more about this topic. Don't forget to subscribe to our channel, to get more inspiration.